From Tokyo, Japan, and Stirling in the United Kingdom, this is Down to Business English with your hosts, Skip Montreux and Dez Morgan.
Good to be talking with you so soon again, Dez. How are things going with you over there in Scotland?
I'll repeat my response from last time we spoke. Busy. However, I've been busy showing visitors around this time, not with work.
Well, that is a better type of busy. Who is visiting, if you don't mind me asking?
Sure, not at all. Some friends from Abu Dhabi.
Oh, nice. And where did you take them?
You know, the usual tourist places, to be honest. Stirling Castle and the Wallace Monument are very close by.
When friends come and visit me here in Tokyo, I usually take them to Meiji Shrine and Yoyogi Park, not to mention Akihabara.
Electronics town. I remember taking people there as well.
So what is the significance of Stirling Castle?
It's on the only hill in town, so any army that controlled the castle pretty much controlled the whole surrounding area.
And the Wallace Monument?
Well, both of William Wallace's major battles were fought in and around Stirling, so they erected a monument to his memory in 1869.
William Wallace of the Braveheart movie fame, played by Mel Gibson.
Yeah, that's him. The Battle of Stirling Bridge was the most famous, which William Wallace won in 1297, and then the Battle of Falkirk, which he sadly lost a year later.
You are living in quite a historic area then.
Indeed. We also visited a couple of whisky distilleries that are nearby, which was very interesting. I got to know how whisky, the water of life as it's known locally, is made, and why each one has its own unique flavor.
The water of life. I like that moniker. I've been known to enjoy a glass of whiskey once in a while.
I'm aware of that, Skip. In fact, when I was at the distilleries, you crossed my mind a few times. I thought Skip would really enjoy this tour.
I'm sure I would. Now, I would imagine that whisky is a pretty big business in Scotland.
It sure is. Would you believe that in 2019, Scotch whisky contributed 21% to the UK's exports of food and drink? Exports of all varieties of whisky in that same year amounted to £4.7 billion, which is around $6.5 billion.
Impressive. I am guessing that this is our story for today, an in-depth Dez Morgan scrutiny of the Scotch whisky industry.
Well, you're partially right. I will be talking about the rebirth of the industry in Scotland, but also two countries that are becoming major players in the whisky industry. And these two countries are much closer to you than they are to me.
Surely not Canada's main whisky distiller, Canadian Club. I'm not a fan of that brand.
Nope, closer to where you are now.
Oh, could it be Japanese whisky?
Japan is one of the countries and the other is China.
They don't make whisky in China, do they?
Maybe not at present, but they soon will be.
Okay, let's do it. Let's get D2B down to business with the whisky industry in Scotland, Japan, and soon to be China. I have to know about China entering the high-end distillery market, Dez. Can we do that first?
Sure. Let's start out in China and work our way backwards.
Cool.
Early in July, the Scottish company Valentine International announced that it sold an entire distillery to China's Mengtai Group.
An entire distillery?
That's correct. All 35 tons of steel and copper piping needed to produce distilled whisky are to be shipped to Tianjin Port and then overland to Inner Mongolia.
Wait a minute, Dez. I always thought Mongolia was an independent country.
Well, you would be referring to Outer Mongolia. That is indeed an independent country. However, Inner Mongolia is an autonomous region of China.
Is that right? I will have to take a closer look at that on Google Maps.
You do that.
So, once the distillery is set up, the Mengtai Group will be up and running making whiskey.
Well, obviously, it's not that simple. Ballantine will be sending 5 experienced distillers as part of the deal to set up the distillery and solve any teething problems with the process of distilling in Inner Mongolia.
That sounds like a good idea, to include a transfer of production knowledge in the deal.
Furthermore, the plant will be constructed by a firm called Rothes in Moray, Scotland, that already has a team in Hong Kong, and they will be able to provide backup and service.
So tell me, are the Chinese big drinkers of whiskey?
In 2017, exports were valued at £60 million, or $75 million. However, this figure was up 26% in terms of volume, and 45% in terms of value from the year before, which shows that China is not only importing more whiskey, but also importing whiskey of a higher quality.
Sounds like whiskey sales in China are booming.
Yes, they are.
And any particular reason why this is?
A piece of legislation that helped the industry came in 2018 when the Chinese government renewed the trademark protection for Scotch whiskey. Since then, there have been over 100 cases of counterfeit producers being prosecuted and subsequently shut down. In other words, Chinese authorities have worked hard to protect the rights of the Scottish producers in the Chinese market.
Well, that sounds like a very positive development. Returning to the distillery that is being shipped to China, do you have any idea what that whiskey will be called?
No one knows as yet. Don't forget that it is a very long process before the spirit will come to the market.
That's right. Making whiskey is not like making soda pop.
No comparison. Whiskey has to be aged in barrels for 10 to 30 years. So Mengtai has a while to consider how to name and brand their product.
Well, hopefully I will still be around at that time and will be able to sample a drop of it when it is finally released.
Stop smoking now, and you may have a chance.
Very funny, but you are probably right. You mentioned that the industry in Scotland has had something of a rebirth in recent years. Can you explain what you mean by that?
I'll start out with a background of the whisky industry in general. Sadly, nearly 70% of Scotland's 126 distilleries are foreign-owned today. London-based Diageo is the biggest player, followed by the French companies Pernod Ricard, Moët Hennessy Louis Vuitton, commonly known as LVMH, and Rémy Cointreau. These European companies are followed by Japan as the third largest overseas owner of Scottish whisky.
I see. I didn't realize that there was so much foreign investment in the industry.
Yes, most of the big names are foreign owned. However, it's the smaller distilleries where the greatest transformation has taken place.
Okay, can you explain more about that to me?
Sure. Let me begin with a personal anecdote. One of the distilleries I visited was Glengoyne, which is just outside Glasgow near Loch Lomond. Glengoyne used to be a feeder distillery for famous grouse, but is now operating as a single malt producer.
Feeder, single malt, what do all of these terms mean?
There are two types of whiskey, blended and single malt. A blended whiskey takes malt from several or even many different sources and blends them together in the cask. Now, in the case of Glengoyne, they supplied one of the malt alcohols that were used to create famous grouse, which is a blended whiskey.
Okay, I think I understand that. And the other type, single malt, means that all of the production comes from a single source.
Correct. Now, Glengoyne was bought in 2003 by Ian MacLeod Distillers from the Edrington Group, an internationally owned distiller. At that point, it became a single malt producer with its entire production being distilled on site.
And, okay, And this is interesting because?
With a single malt whiskey, any issues with the quality or the taste can't be covered up by blending with another variety. In other words, the quality of the entire process has to be superior for the final product to pass muster.
So what you are saying is that some of the smaller distilleries have upped the quality of their whiskey.
Exactly. More interestingly, though, there has been an explosion of new distilleries opening over the last few years.
Oh, hold your horses there, Dez. Didn't you say that it takes upwards of 10 years for whiskey to be ready to drink?
I did.
So how are these new distilleries going to stay afloat for the next 10 plus years?
One word answer to that, Skip. Gin.
Gin? We are doing a story about whiskey and now you're talking about gin?
Yes, I am. Craft gins have also truly exploded in the UK over the last 10 years. There are 280 gin distilleries currently trading in Scotland and 563 in the UK as a whole. However, this number is a bit misleading as 70% of the UK's production comes from Scotland. Compare that to 2013, when there were just 140 gin distilleries across Scotland.
So that number has doubled in just 8 years.
Exactly true. Of course, the big advantage of gin is that it doesn't need to be aged like whiskey does.
I'm getting it now. Distilleries can produce whiskey and lay it down in the cask while simultaneously producing gin, which brings in immediate cash flow.
Once again, you're exactly right, Skip. And much of the expertise and machinery used is the same for both types of spirit.
So, in about 10 or 15 years' time, there will be some new and exciting whiskies coming onto the market.
It appears so.
And Scotland will still be making the best whiskey in the world.
Slow down there, partner. Remember I said that Japan is the third biggest owner of Scottish distilleries? And whiskey has been produced in Japan since all the way back in 1924.
Sure, I know the story of how whiskey first came to Japan.
Really? What do you know about it?
Well, Masataka Taketsuru, the father of the Japanese whiskey industry, he traveled to Scotland in 1918. He was intent on learning the secrets of Scotch whiskey.
That's right.
And while in Scotland, he fell in love with Rita Cohen, from Glasgow, near you. And the couple were later married. After becoming a master blender in Scotland, the Taketsuru couple came back to Japan and helped start the Yamazaki Distillery, which later became Suntory.
Very good, Skip.
And one more important point about Masataka Taketsuru. He left Yamazaki and started his own whiskey distillery in Hokkaido in 1934. He went to Hokkaido because he felt it was most geographically like Scotland. That distillery later became Nikka Whiskey.
Wow! I didn't know you were so knowledgeable.
There is a lot you don't know about me, Mr. Morgan.
No doubt. So Japan has a long-established distilling industry, but the quality was not particularly great. However, after Japan buys several distilleries in Scotland, they
brought the lessons they learned in Scotland back to Japan and started making some decent whiskies.
No, Skip. They started to produce some outstanding whiskies. Listen to these results from the 2020 Whiskey Awards. Best single malt in the world, Hakushu, 25 years old. Best limited edition blended whiskey, Chichibu Ichiro's Malt Japanese Blended Whiskey. Best Grain Whiskey? Fuji Single Grain 30-Year-Old Small Batch.
I really need to try a bottle of Hakushu.
Good luck with that. The Hakushu 25-Year-Old is in very high demand and very short supply. Bottles sell for upwards of $6,000, if you can find one, of course.
Oh dear, that is definitely out of my price range.
Mine too. Well, I hope you enjoyed that whiskey-fueled tour around Asia and Scotland.
I sure did. I can almost taste the first sip of Hakushu, Or maybe some Fuji single grain. Straight, not on the rocks. I don't want to salt anyone.
If I can get Skip back from his whiskey reverie, it's time for us to get D2V down to vocabulary.
Down to Business English audio scripts are a great learning tool and can help you get the most out of each episode. Be sure to visit the D2B website and download your free audio script of today's podcast. DownToBusinessEnglish.com. That's DownToBusinessEnglish.com.
I am back from my reverie, and just before we get going with D2V, I want to mention something about the spelling of whiskey. Is it spelled W-H-I-S-K-Y or W-H-I-S-K-E-Y?
That is a good question, Skip. Actually, both spellings are correct. If the whiskey comes from Scotland, it's spelt W-H-I-S-K-Y. If it comes from Ireland, it is W-H-I-S-K-E-Y.
Ah, so in Canada, which has a lot of Scottish influence, it is usually written without the E. And in the US, where there was a very large immigrant population from Ireland, it is commonly spelled with an E.
And with Japanese whiskey being so influenced by Scotland, it's spelled without the E as well.
Wow, that all makes a lot of sense. Okay, I will get the D2V ball rolling with the noun scrutiny. As a verb, when you scrutinize something, you study it carefully and in depth. In the introduction, I commented that today's story was a Des Morgan scrutiny of the whiskey industry. In other words, Dez was going to report on his very carefully researched topic of whiskey.
Scrutiny is the noun, and as Skip just mentioned, scrutinize is the verb. In a business context, forensic accounting is when accountants scrutinize a company's records, looking for money that is missing or taxes that have not been paid.
I know that there are months where a serious scrutiny of my bank account statements is needed so that I can figure out where my money has gone.
I second that. Moving on, I will now discuss the expression teething problems, which means when difficulties arise at the start of a project or undertaking. In the story, I mentioned that the company Valentine was sending 5 members of staff in case the new distillery in China hit any teething problems.
We should mention that teething comes from the stage in a baby's life when their first set of teeth are coming in. It is a little bit of a painful process.
That's right. Can you give us another example using teething?
Sure. We have been trying out a new video conferencing program at work recently. And wow, there have been a lot of teething problems with internet connections freezing or being lost. However, once we get past these few teething problems, I hope it will work well for us in the future.
Good luck with that.
Thank you. Next up, we have the noun anecdote, which is a personal story that happened to you or someone you know. In the story, Dez told us that he was going to add in a personal anecdote to the story on whiskey. In other words, he wanted to tell us about a personal experience he had had related to whiskey.
The adjective form anecdotal is often used to show that the evidence or proof that you have of something is based purely on personal experience. Let's say, for example, you're thinking about getting a new company car and you decide to ask a friend for his or her opinion. He or she might say that they once owned that particular model and their anecdotal evidence was that it was terribly unreliable. However, They might go on to say that they've read great reports on the internet, so their anecdotal evidence might just have been down to bad luck.
You have had a lot of trouble with your car recently, I think.
I have indeed. I think my anecdotal evidence really points to a bad garage, though, rather than the model of car.
Oh dear, I'm very sorry to hear that.
No worries, it will get sorted out one way or another. We'll be finishing up with another expression that is to pass muster, which means to meet a certain standard.
To pass muster comes from the military and means to pass an inspection by a senior officer.
In the story, I said that single malt distillers have to create a higher quality product in order to meet the standard or pass muster.
If I worked in the catering industry, my kitchen would be inspected every year. If hygiene standards are being upheld, then the inspector will allow us to pass muster and continue serving food to the public.
I'm sure your kitchens would be spotless, Skip.
Really? Well, thank you. You have more confidence than I do.
Would you like to support Down to Business English? Help D2B reach more people wanting to improve their business English skills. Be sure to subscribe to Down to Business English on Apple Podcasts or any place podcasts are found. While you are there, why don't you leave a rating and a review? Down to Business English. Business news to improve your business English.
Thank you so much for that report on the whisky industry, Dez. I personally love the stuff, and I am happy that we could cover it from a business angle.
I'm glad it passed your muster, Skip. I did know that you were a bit of a whisky drinker, so I thought you'd enjoy it.
Just anecdotally, I once visited the Suntory Yamazaki distillery between Osaka and Kyoto many years ago. Any whisky lover who visits Japan must make that a stop on their itinerary.
I never did visit a whisky distillery during my time in Japan. If I ever make it back there, I will certainly try to do so.
I highly recommend that. Now, just before we sign off for today, I would like to say to all of our listeners out there, if you found today's D2B episode on the whisky industry useful for your English self-studies, if it has passed your muster, then please consider becoming a D2B member. Memberships come with 4 benefits.
And what would they be, Skip?
Number 1, access to the entire audio script library. Number 2, audio scripts of newly released episodes are automatically emailed to you. Number 3, D2B members get exclusive content in the form of members-only episodes. And number 4, every D2B membership helps us produce episodes on a more regular and more consistent basis.
4 excellent reasons to become a Down to Business English member.
To learn more about becoming a D2B member, just visit the Down to Business English website and click on the membership link at the top of the page. Thanks for listening, everyone. See you next time.
Bye-bye.
Have a comment or question about today's show? Don't be shy. Visit the D2B website or Facebook page and post any comments or questions there. Skip, Dez, or Samantha will be sure to leave a reply. Down to Business English. Business news to improve your business English.